we now introduce a very important example of a stack, which can be associated with any geometric morphism. So the idea is really to refer to what we have seen earlier concerning the way of inducing a comorphism of sites from the given geometric morphism regarded as a morphism of sites via its inverse image. So you see here we have as domain of this comorphism of sites a comma category. And in fact, the projection functor from this comma category to E is actually a stack, which we call the canonical stack of the morphism. And we can easily describe this from an indexed point of view because it simply sends an object of the base topos to the topos, the relative topos, to the inverse image of the object under the morphism. And at the level of arrows, it acts as the pullback functor. So you see in particular that we indeed have a pseudo functor and not a strict functor. So it's natural to call the Grothendieck topology on the comma category, which is induced by the other projection, the one to F, because we want actually this to induce an equivalence at the topos level with the topos F. So this is why we have to induce the topology from F. So this topology, it's natural to call it the relative topology of F. Because in fact, this gives rise a first example of a relative site. You see, we have a stack and a topology, a Grothendieck topology on this stack. And by taking sheaves on this relative site, we get the source topos of our morphism. So it's interesting to look at what happens if we take F to be the identity. Of course, we can take the identical morphism and on a topos. And if we choose a site of definition for this topos, we obtain this so-called canonical stack on the given site, which sends any object of the category underlying the site to the corresponding slice topos. And in fact, this relative site, if we regard it in the context of this canonical site, of the canonical site of this identical morphism, well, it gives us, you see, a sort of categorical thickening of the usual representation of a topos as the sheaves on itself for the canonical topology. So it's quite interesting because it's something richer in terms of structure, but the idea is the same, like regarding a topos as sheaves over itself. And here we see that we can not just regard as normal sheaves, but also relative sheaves, which are richer. Okay, so now I would like to describe what happens at the level of operations on stacks that we might want to perform. You see, I mentioned that stacks are generalizations of sheaves. So with sheaves, we are able to operate by taking, for instance, direct and inverse images. So can we do similar things for stacks? Well, yes, in fact, most of the theory generalizes quite smoothly. You see, first of all, you can observe that whenever you have a functor F from C to D, composing with F yields a two functor from the category of index category over D to the category of index category over C. So this is just the precomposition. But what is interesting is that as in the pre-shift case, we have two adjoints, one on the right and one on the left, which we can call the pseudo CAN extensions. Indeed, they are defined in a similar way to the usual CAN extensions, except that here you see we replace the category of sets with the category of small categories cut. Of course, sometimes it's possible also to take values in bigger categories by using some cofinality arguments. I mean, these colimits can make sense also more generally, but to be technically rigorous, here we restrict to index categories taking values in small ones. And we also restrict to small generated sites or even small sites if necessary. Okay, so they are defined like this. So similarly as you define left and right CAN extensions, you see what changes here is that we take values in CAT and therefore we take the appropriate notion of colimit there, which is the notion of pseudo colimit. So it's a kind of two categorical colimit. And it is the right one to take because indeed one can prove that we have such two adjunctions. Okay, so this is the starting point for understanding the action of morphisms and comorphisms of sites on categories of stacks. Because remember, so I just come back to that for you to fix the ideas. We had seen that we had characterized the action of morphisms and comorphisms of sites at the level of the corresponding categories of sheaves in terms of CAN extensions. So you see direct image was, for instance, for a morphism was given simply by composition with the functor, but the inverse image involved the left CAN extension, and in a sort of dual way, for comorphisms, the direct image involved the right CAN extension, which restricted to sheaves. And the inverse image instead was just given by composition. And so we are going to have an analog of that in the context of stacks. So let's come back to where we were. Okay, so you see, we have these fundamental ingredients, the pseudo CAN extensions. Then we are now make use of them in a formally similar way as we have done for sheaves. So a preliminary remark that is very interesting is that in fact, a priori you might wonder, is the notion of continuous functor also the right one for stacks? Because remember that Grothendieck defined the continuity in terms of the condition that composing with that would preserve the sheaf condition. In fact, you can prove that composing with any continuous functor also preserves the stack condition. So in fact, you don't need to introduce any other notion. The continuity notion you have for sheaves equally works well for stacks, which is very good. And so of course, every morphism of sites in particular is continuous. And therefore, it induces a two adjunction. Which in fact represents the analog of the geometric morphism induced by a morphism of sites. So what is interesting about this is that in fact both the direct and inverse image of this morphism between categories of stacks can be described very nicely in vibrational terms. So concerning the direct image, in fact, it can be described vibrationally just by taking the pullback along the functor. And concerning the inverse image, well, it is a bit more complicated, but still we have a nice vibrational description obtained by considering, first of all, the vibration of generalized elements of the composite functor. So we take the composite of the functor with the given vibration. So then we get a vibration out of that by taking the generalized elements of that. And in fact, in order to, so this will would give a lax colimit, but since we want a pseudo colimit, we will localize this vibration, and this will give the required description for the pseudo left hand. So I'm not going to enter into details. In any case, this slide will be available after the course, and so you will be able to check everything. And also, of course, for even more details, there is our forthcoming text, which you will be able to read from next week. Okay, so we have talked about morphisms of sites, but things work very smoothly also for comorphisms. So when you have a comorphism of sites, similarly, it induces a two adjunction at the level of the corresponding categories of stacks. So the right adjoint, as in the case of sheaves, is given by the restriction of the right of pseudo-can extension, while the left adjoint is related just to composition with F. Of course, you have to stackify in order to make sure that you end up in the category of stacks. Then it's interesting also to remark that if the comorphism is moreover continuous, and we have already said that in the context of vibrations, we actually have many such functors and comorphisms, then we have a further adjoint, a left adjoint to the inverse image of the morphism between categories of stacks, which is given by the pseudo left can extension again with the composition, with the stackification. Now, what is nice about continuous comorphisms of sites is that you see we have a result in the pre-sheaf bundle adjunction, which I stressed as a very interesting result, the fact that one could compute the inverse image of sheaves in terms of the corresponding etal bundles as a pullback, which was geometrically very pleasing, you see. So in fact, we had an analog of that here. So, I mean, you can describe the effect of the inverse image of stacks along a geometric morphisms in terms of pullbacks in the category of toposes involving zero toposes. But this happens at the level of toposes, and okay, it's nice. But here we have something more. I mean, if F is a continuous comorphism of sites, we can understand this pullback already at the site level, in the sense that by considering a pseudo pullback in cut of the corresponding vibration, I mean, for any stack, you see, we consider the corresponding vibration. We consider the pseudo pullback, and we know that this pseudo pullback will be sent by the functor inducing morphisms from comorphisms of site to a pullback in toposes. So you see, this is really an analog of this vibrational way of understanding the action of inverse images on sheaves, and in this case, stacks. So it's quite pleasing. Okay, so now I would like to focus on the main topic of this last lecture, namely relative toposes. So how relative toposes are formally defined? Well, the analog of relative pre-sheaf toposes was essentially defined by Giraud in his paper Classifying Topos. And in fact, so the analog of pre-sheaf toposes in the stack setting is given by toposes of sheaves on the given stack, or more generally the given vibration with respect to the Giraud topology. So this actually is the right notion of relative pre-sheaf topos. Why? Well, because we have this proposition, which in fact generalizes a proposition already present in the paper of Giraud, which ensures us that this toposes as built by Giraud satisfy the desired property, because you see they are equivalent to categories of indexed functors from the opposite of D, because here I have an index category D and I take the opposite of it. It's just defined fiber-wise. No problem. So I have an opposite notion of index category, and I consider the index functors from the opposite of that to what is our analog for the topos of sets. You see, here we are in relative topos theory, so we change, we replace the topos of sets with an arbitrary base topos. And so we replace the topos of sets with the canonical stack of the topos. And so you see that this is really what we want. So this ensures that Giraud's construction is really the right one. And now we are going to say something interesting about the construction of such Giraud toposes, which will yield our fundamental adjunction, as I mentioned in the previous slide. So, in fact, the main result is that we can represent a Giraud topos as, in a very natural way, as a weighted colimit of etal toposes, where the weight is given by the pseudo functor itself. So let's explain this in more detail. So first we have to recall the notion of weighted colimit. So this is a notion of two categorical colimit that is useful in many situations. It's a very nice notion, geometrically very appealing, and it is really what we need in order to have a very nice construction for the Giraud toposes. If you have two categories, two categories C and D, C and K, and suppose you have a pseudo functor D on COP, this will play the role of our weight, and a pseudo functor R. So this will be the diagram over which we are going to consider the colimit. So it will be a colimit of R indexed by D, okay? So so the D-weighted pseudo-colimit of R is defined as an object of the target category, which satisfies this universal property that the category of arrows from this this weighted pseudo-colimit to an arbitrary object K should be equivalent to the category of weighted pseudo cocons on the given R. So what is a pseudo cocon? Well, we can visualize that as follows. So what the changes with respect to the usual cocons is that you don't have just one leg. You can have multiple legs related to each other by two morphisms. You see, but that's simply, so you see that the classical colimits, the conical colimits are obtained by taking the weight to be the trivial one in which you have just one object category, you see. But it's very natural to authorize having categories that are bigger than just the one object one, the one object and one arrow one. So here we authorize arbitrary categories as provided by a pseudo functor, and so this is how a pseudo cocon looks like, and so our theorem is that the Giraud topos can be realized as a weighted pseudo colimit of a diagram of etal toposes. Here is the picture. So you see, our etal toposes are really those which come from the bases, the base site. So they correspond to the objects of C. So here you see that these are actually slice toposes, sheaves on C over X and JX. This can also be represented as the etal topos on the image of X under the canonical functor, and similarly for Y. So you see, these are the etal toposes which arise in the colimit representation. And the legs of these weighted cocoons are provided by morphisms of fibrations, which are in turn induced by the fiber you need lemma. So basically, if you want to get an object of a fibration in a certain fiber, well, it suffices to take a morphism of fibration from C over that object to the vibration. So it's just the fiber that you need a lemma. And of course, since you can have several objects in one fiber, this is why you have a weighted colimit, because you have several such legs, which also can be related, of course, by morphisms, because a fibration is a category. So you have morphisms. Okay, so this is the picture. Now, the universal property of the weighted pseudo colimit is precisely what gives us the fundamental adjunction I mentioned in the previous slides. Because we have two pseudofunctors, one pseudofunctor lambda and another one gamma. So lambda is what takes the Giroud-Topos construction, which of course is functorial, so no problem, is even two functorial. And in the converse direction, the gamma functor is a sort of home functor from the canonical stack on the site to the given relative topos. And indeed, this adjunction can be seen as induced by a schizophrenic object which is precisely given by the canonical stack. So you see, you home into that in different categories. So, okay. So sorry, I cannot give a lot of details because of time constraints, but of course, if you are interested, you will be able to study all of this carefully through the references I should give. Okay. So now I would like just to briefly say what happens in the discrete setting. I mean, because of course, so far we have talked about arbitrary vibrations and arbitrary index categories. Of course, pre-shifts can be seen as index categories and they correspond to discrete vibrations. So it's natural to wonder what happens if we restrict this fundamental adjunction in the discrete setting. So in order to get something which really generalizes the usual pre-shift bundle adjunction for topological spaces in the context of an arbitrary site and for arbitrary pre-shift. So for this, there is just a size issue to be fixed. So we are going to restrict to the geometric morphisms that are small relatively to the base, in the sense that when we consider geometric morphisms from metal topos to them, they should form a set. This is because we want our pre-shifts to take values in sets. So this is a necessary requirement, but that's the only thing one has to care about because everything works perfectly well. So we have an adjunction of one categories where on the one end we have the pre-shifts on C. And on the other hand, we have relative small toposes over the base topos. So the two functors work like this. So a pre-shift is sent to the corresponding local homeomorphism. But look, this local homeomorphism can be presented in terms of comorphisms of sites because you have the canonical fibration associated with P, which is a comorphism of size if you put the Giroud topology there. And in fact, the local homeomorphism is precisely induced by such comorphism of size. So you can understand this in terms of comorphism of size. In the converse direction, the gamma functor acts, as we have already said, like a home functor. Remember that in the topological setting, the gamma functor was the functor of cross sections, you see, over open sets of the given bundle. Here, what we have is a functor, a home functor, where instead of taking the open sets, we take the categorification of that, namely arbitrary objects of the base category, you see, identified with the corresponding discrete vibrations through the through the canonical stack. Okay, so you see all of this is very natural, very satisfying, and in fact, as in the topological setting, this adjunction restricts to an equivalence between sheaves on the one hand and ethal morphisms on the other. Now, a pleasing property that that the pre-sheaf bundle adjunction led to is the possibility of describing the sheafification functor as the composite of the two functors in the adjunction. And here we have exactly the same thing. So we can understand the sheafification as the composite of gamma and lambda. This is very nice from a geometric viewpoint because it allows us to really understand concretely all the elements of the sheafification. You see? So they are not formal things, they are morphisms. So an element of the sheafification is a geometric morphism, which can be locally represented as being induced by morphisms of vibrations. And in fact, this relates strictly with the construction of the sheafification functors in terms of locally matching families of elements of the pre-sheaf, which I have already talked about in the first part of the course. So you see that really it's nice to have such an adjunction because it really allows us to reason geometrically about all of this. So to regard the topologies as they were topological spaces, essentially. So just a few remarks about the descriptions for direct and inverse images of sheaves in terms of vibrations that we have in the discrete setting, because things simplify to a certain extent when we restricted to the discrete setting. Well, we have already said that a direct image corresponds to taking a pullback, so here there is no difference. But concerning the action of the inverse image, here we can refer to the relative comprehensive factorization to get a very nice description of that. So more precisely, the inverse image of a sheaf P under the geometric morphism induced by a morphism of size F is given by the discrete part of the K comprehensive factorization of the composite functor F composed with the vibration associated with P. So you see, this is a universal characterization of that. So you don't need to make your hands dirty to understand what it is. And in fact, we have also natural analog of, in particular, this last result in the context of stacks, but they are a little bit more sophisticated. So I'm not presenting them in this course. But you see how natural is the language of vibration in this context. Okay, so now we are ready to talk about relative sheaf topologies. So we have already identified the right analog of pre-sheaf topologies in the relative setting. Now it remains to consider the subtopologies of such relative pre-sheaf topologies. We know that really the right notion to consider is the notion of subtopos, because it is the invariant notion which is able to capture the notion of Grothendieck topology. So we are using that to define what a relative site should be. So starting from a small generated site, we consider, first of all, the pre-sheaf topos, the zero topos, so which is the sheaves on the on the Grothendieck construction of the given index category with the zero topology. And for us, a relative site will be just, an index category, in particular a stack, if you want, and a Grothendieck topology on the corresponding Grothendieck construction, which contains the gyrotopology. Because remember that subtoposes of a topos of ships on a certain site correspond precisely, it was recalled yesterday, in particular by Charles Redskin in his course, so they correspond precisely to the Grothendieck topologies on the category which contain the given topology. So here, this is how we define things. Okay, so a relative topology is actually a topology on the Grothendieck category. So a Grothendieck category is actually something two-dimensional, if you want, because you see it takes into account what happens in the base. So we can think of this as the horizontal component, but it also takes into account what happens in the fibers. And this is the vertical component. So it's really a two-dimensional entity. And so, as you can imagine, in terms of expressiveness, we get really a lot by passing from ordinary sites to relative sites. In particular, we might wonder if it's possible to classify in some way these relative topologies, but for instance, by using horizontal or vertical data. So one can show that, in fact, not every Grothendieck topology, as you might naturally expect on the Grothendieck category, can be generated by just horizontal or vertical data or both of them. No, because I mean, basically the idea is to get the diagonal, you it's not enough to get the two sides. So you cannot reduce two-dimensionality to one-dimensionality, okay? But in practice, it's a matter of fact that many relative topologies actually are induced by sets of horizontal and vertical data. So here is a list of examples. So, of course, we have already encountered the relative topology on the canonical stack of a geometric morphism, and you can see easily that this there are no chances in general that is going to be generated by horizontal or vertical data. On the other hand, the Giraud topology is an example of a relative topology generated by horizontal data, you see, because it's something which entirely comes from the base. In another direction, Grothendieck introduced the notion of a fiber site without putting any Grothendieck topology on the base category. So in that setting, you have just vertical data. And so the total topology on the Grothendieck category that he defines is an example of a topology generated by vertical data. Of course, as you can imagine, there are also nice topologies that are generated by a mixture of horizontal and vertical data. One such example is a topology we have introduced in a joint work with Axel Osmond. So this work is actually going to be presented in a contributed talk at the conference next week by Axel. So this topology we have introduced for constructing the overtopos at a model, and it is a topology defined on the stack of its generalized elements, is an example of a mixed relative topology. So it's a very interesting topology. In fact, it's the join of two Giraud topologies. And in fact, we were able to get an explicit presentation for such a topology in terms of a basis. So then with Riccardo, we have been wondering whether one could get a more general result, whenever we present a topology by using horizontal and vertical data, which satisfies some nice compatibility condition between themselves, is it possible to calculate a basis, an explicit basis for the generated topology? Well, in fact, we have a very nice result about that, showing that under some very natural assumptions, it's possible to get explicit descriptions of bases for such topologies. In particular, I would like to point out that comma toposes, as introduced by Deligne in the context of vanishing cycles, etc., in fact, can be presented by using such kind of topologies. And I have a forthcoming paper on that, in which I provide explicit basis for these topologies that in general are quite hard to describe because they are presented by using different sets of horizontal and vertical data. So you see, in general, calculating a Grothendieck topology generated by a family of sieves is a non-trivial problem. It can be very easy in some situations, but in general, certainly, it's not a trivial. So in that case, it's not a trivial, but we are in a situation like this where we have horizontal and vertical generators which behave well with respect to each other. And therefore, in such a situation, in fact, we have bases for describing these topologies which are given by multi-compositions of horizontal covering families with vertical ones. Mm-hmm. But again, you will find the details in our work. Okay, so finally, I would like to mention that another kind of work in progress we are pursuing with Riccardo is to identify the logical counterpart of this geometric approach to relative topologies in order to introduce a sort of relative geometric logic. So just a few remarks about this to illustrate the spirit in which we are working. So in fact, if you take the classical formulation of geometric logic, there are no parameters there. So it's because it was designed starting from classical model theory. You see, it was inspired by first order logic in its classical formulation. So you have sorts that are going to be interpreted as objects, function symbols, relation symbols. But then you have variables and you see, for instance, you don't have the parameters embedded in the formalism. For instance, suppose you want to formalize the notion of a vector space over a given field, where the field for you is, you want to think of it as a parameter, so you want it to be fixed, you want its interpretation to be fixed in any model, you see. So there is no syntactic gadget embedded in the geometric logic formalism for doing that. But you can introduce that, of course, without changing its level of expressivity. And in fact, it's very important to do that because if you stay just with the base topos of sets, you don't need to talk about parameters. It is not so important because you don't make changes of base. But when you make changes of base and you want to reason in a vibrational way, parameters become really fundamental. And therefore, it is important that they are fully integrated in the logical formalism, if we want to have a very nice correspondence between logic and geometry, as we have in the case of geometric logic. So, in fact, the logical formalism we are developing is a kind of vibrational higher order parametric logic, in which the parameters basically are what happens in the base topos. And by using these parameters, actually, one can increase the degree of expressivity of the logic in order to accommodate a certain number of higher order constructions. Mm? So you see, by changing the universe, you can formulate things in a simple way relative to that universe, but then the universe itself can be quite rich. And so externally, you will get something more expressive. Mm? So that's the basic idea. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say in this course. So I just leave you with a list of references. So some of the results I have presented come from the monograph I have already mentioned several times in the course of the talk. So this is available on the archive already from last year. Then there is this very big monograph we are writing with Riccardo on relative topologies, from which the results I have presented in the last part of the course are taken from. So this should be available very soon on the archive, hopefully already next week. In fact, I would also like to mention that Riccardo is going to give a talk on the discrete fundamental adjunction at the conference next week. So today I was very short on that, deliberately, because he's going to give you more detail about that if you are interested. And then, of course, for all the things which concern the bridge technique and how it can be applied in different contexts, also the general philosophy, you can refer to my book. And also another natural reference is my habilitation thesis, which is written as an overview of bridges in different areas of mathematics, which have been discovered in the last years. And this can be downloaded from my website. Okay, so I guess that's all. So thank you very much for your attention.